from closeness to hermeticity. So I don't want to make things very general as in the previous talk, so I'm going on the proof in the case where we are dealing with the group G is SL4R and U is the group of upper triangular matrices, block upper triangular matrices with identity on the diagonal, and B is a 2 by 2 matrix with real coefficient. And the theorem I want to discuss, and I began to prove in lecture 2, is a theorem which was a special case of very general statement for a semi-simple group. In this special case, it's due to Hio. And it tells you that if I take gamma discrete Zariski dense subgroup of G, such that the intersection of gamma with this orospherical group U is co-compact in U. Then gamma is commensurable to the Z point of some Q form of G, so to some GZ, meaning there is a way to see G as a group of matrices defined by polynomial coefficient with coefficient in Q, and you take the Z point, and by Borel Harishchandra, we know that such a group is a lattice in G. So as a consequence, each time you have this assumption, as a conclusion, you get that gamma is a lattice. Okay, as I told you, Margulis was able to prove this was Margulis' first arithmeticity theorem, that if you assume it is a lattice, that gamma is a lattice, then it will be automatically Zariski dense and it will satisfy this kind of property. And the main conclusion of Margulis was that then it is arithmetic, it is commensurable to some GZ. And but at the very beginning, he assumed that gamma is a lattice, what we do not assume here. But as you will see, part of his proof used that gamma was a lattice, part did not use it. And I will reuse part of his proof, I will tell you exactly which one. So this is what I plan to do for this hour, to finish the proof of that. I will recall to you what we have done last time. We were able to prove that some orbit was closed. And I will try to explain to you how, what are the arguments to deduce from the closeness of the orbit that the group is in fact arithmetic, is commensurable to some GZ. And in lecture 4, next hour, I have the feeling that you will be tired, so I will go down to G equal SL3R. So I will prove the same theorem for SL3R. Okay, but you will see, in fact, the arguments are more difficult. That's why I began by SL4. Now, what we did last time is we said, okay, since gamma is Zariski dense, I'm able to find some element G0 in gamma such that G0 U G0 minus 1 is opposite to U. Meaning you are able, what I'm exactly saying on G0 is that I'm able, here I will give precise definition. My G0, I can write it A G0, B G0, C G0, D G0, block matrices. And this condition opposite will be just the determinant of this block is non-zero. And why is it interesting to do that? It's because I can change the basis. R4 from if the basis was E1, E2, E3, E4, you see the shape of U depends only on E3, E4, on these two planes. So I change the basis. The new basis I want to choose is, in fact, G0 E3, G0 E4, E3 E4. So that's a new basis. And this group U minus, which is the conjugate of U by G0, in this new basis, you keep the same shape, but U minus now has a new shape. It's a set of matrices 1, 0, C, 1, with C, 2 by 2 matrices with real coefficient. And it's nice because since I'm conjugated by an element of gamma, then the group delta minus, which is G0 delta G0 minus 1, is co-compact in U minus. So let me sum up. I have made some change of basis to arrive to this new situation of having gamma containing both a lattice in U and U minus. If you really start from the very beginning with U and U minus, and if you have a Zariski dense group, you may be not able to find element. If you have element in U, you may be not able to find element in U minus. But if you do this change, you arrive to this situation where you have this group delta and delta minus. And what I did last time, I said, OK, let L0 be the set of matrices A0, 0D, such that the determinant of A is the determinant of D is 1. And so it's a group which is isomorphic to SL2R cross SL2R. And the key proposition that we proved completely last time, you had this second lecture was a complete proof of this key proposition, which is the L0 orbit at least we proved it for the single orbit, and for the double orbit it's the same. The L0 orbit, L0 applied to the couple delta minus is closed. It's a closed orbit in XU cross XU minus. And XU was the space of covolume 1 lattices in U. Which was something like SL4R over SL4Z. And you have two copies of it. And so you have this closed orbit in this space, which is a finite volume homogeneous space. And now we want to deduce the theorem from the key proposition. Okay? So, are there questions for lecture two that I just sum up?
I'm confused by something. A moment ago you said you will be working on the SFPR case, and at the end you still have here SFPR chances.
So G is SL4R.
Yeah.
Okay. And U is a subgroup of G, which is made of block. It's a group of 4x4 matrices made of 2x2. Yeah, you look at them as block matrices, and the size of the block are 2x2. So this makes this L0, which is the group, a subgroup of SL4R, which is in fact the intersection of the normalizer of U and normalizer of U minus. Uh-huh. And so this group is a subgroup of SL4R, but as a group, it is isomorphic to SL2R cross SL2R. Okay? But your remark is a good remark, okay? Because there is a four which are, there are two four which are not the same. So here, this four, you can think of it as 2D. Okay? And you have block D by D matrices. Okay? Here, this will be D, and D, SLD cross SLD, okay? But then, in this case, U has dimension D square. And when you let L0 act on U, it acts on some space of dimension D square. So this 4 is a D square. So, yeah. So to study this group SL4, you have to study the action of SL2D of SLD cross SLD in some space of dimension, on some space of some homogeneous space of lattices in a vector space of dimension D square. So which makes this space itself of dimension D to the 4 minus 1. This is a huge dimension. Okay, but so we have this statement. And what I want to deduce from this statement, maybe I say a word the way we proved it last time. We introduced, because I will reuse it. Maybe not. And I will not reuse it. Okay. So the first part is to go from closeness to infinite. Stabilizer. Okay, so this is the following proposition, which tells you that in some situation, when you have a closed orbit, this closed orbit has in fact finite volume. And since L0 as infinite volume, this will be that the stabilizer is non-trivial. And then we will use the non-triviality of the stabilizer. But as you see, I will apply it to this action of L0, which is this semi-simple group, acting on this big space. So the best is to have a general result. And this is the following proposition, which I think should be attributed to Dani and Margulis. Which is, so let S0 be, so it will be very general, but you think let G0 be a Lie group, maybe contains lambda 0, a lattice, and x0 is a finite volume homogeneous space, g0 over lambda 0. So what will g0 will be SL4R cross SL4R, and lambda 0 will be SL4Z cross SL4Z. And then I will have a point here, the base point, x0, which will be this point, delta delta minus. And what do I have? I have a subgroup which is semi-simple. And if the statement is that if the orbit S0, X0 is closed, then S0 intersection lambda 0 is a lattice in S0. This means that the orbit, in fact, has finite volume. That's the definition of being a lattice. Okay, so this is thanks to this proposition, let's call it proposition 2, that I will go from this closeness of the orbit, that you have a group here, a stabilizer, which is infinite because it's a lattice in something which is not compact. Are there questions? So what I plan to do is to give kind of a proof of proposition 2. But what I found nice in explaining this proposition is that it puts together arguments from the so-called homogeneous dynamics. So it will use ergodic theory, a little bit of ergodic theory in a very nice way. So, but I will take for granted the result of ergodic theory. So those are two famous results which have been proven in the maybe 70s and in the 90s. So I will quote them. One is a mixing theorem, the other is a recurrence theorem. And then I will explain how from these two theorems you deduce this proposition. So it's not like the first talk where I gave no proof, or like the second talk where I give all the proof. Here it's in between. So to prove this proposition 2, we will first need a fact, which is a so-called Hauer-Mur theorem. But Hauer-Mur should be thought as a mixing theorem. So let me give the statement of Hauer-Mur theorem, or one statement of Hauer-Mur theorem. It tells you that you start with S0, which is a semi-simple group. So Si are the simple factor. And it starts with a unitary representation of this S0. H0 pi 0 is a unitary representation of S0. This means that H0 is a Hilbert space and pi 0 is a morphism from S0 inside the group of unitary transformation of H0 with some continuity property that I will not enter in. And you assume that there are no invariant vectors such that if you look at the S0 invariant vector, which is a set of vector V in your Hilbert space H0, such that which are not moved by S0, this is 0. So this is the definition of the S0 invariant vector, and the assumption is that there are no invariant vectors. And then what you do is you look at the coefficients. So you look for every then, for every VW in H0, if you look at the coefficient pi of S VW, this is the scalar product in my Hilbert space. I have two elements of my Hilbert space. I push one of the elements by an element S of the group because they have a representation. And I look at the scalar product. So this is called the coefficient. And the statement is that this is going to 0 when S is going to infinity. And not only S has to go to infinity, but all its projection on all the Si, so in all Si.
You mean pi 0?
Pi 0, thank you. So this is the statement of Hauer-Mur mixing theorem, okay? That if you have no invariant vector, the coefficients are going to 0. And you will see why we call it mixing, because in general, you apply this kind of theorem to a Hilbert space of functions. And one very important example is when those functions are characteristic functions of sets. So then you see that you have characteristic function of a set B, characteristic function of a set A, and it tells you how the action move A, and when you compare its intersection with B, you see that the proportion of A in of the image of A by S in B is given by the mass of A. So okay, so it's a mixing result. Here is a precise statement. So this is one I will use, and this is the other one, and I need some room on the blackboard. So I will go here. The fact 2, which is Danny Margulis. Recurrence theorem. And this tells you maybe before quoting fact 2, I would like to tell you why sometimes proposition 2 is not correct. Why you need this assumption that S0 is semi-simple. So maybe I give an example. Here, it's not true when S0 is not semi-simple. So we will have to use semi-simple. We will use it in Haumur. But let's see. And it helps you understand what it means, what this statement means. So the example is to take X0, this space, to be SL2R over SL2Z. And as a subgroup, I will call it L0 instead of S0. L0, I take the diagonal group. So this is a matrices which take axes on R2. It contracts in this direction and expands in this direction. So if you look at the orbit of the standard lattice, which is Z2, you contract in this direction, you expand in this direction. So you see that this orbit is closed. But there is no stabilizer. So this orbit is closed and has infinite volume. So as a pitcher, you can do it that way. You think of this quotient as a unit tangent space of the hyperbolic plane. You have the quotient, so it has this kind of, maybe I draw it like it to make it more fancy, but it's a cover of this one. And how is your L0 orbit? It's a geodesic there. And this geodesic may be closed without being compact. So how can this happen? If it is not a compact geodesic, this means that it has to come from the infinity here, maybe do something here, I don't know, and then go back to infinity. So this is my L0 orbit. So this is possible because I gave you an example here, but you have a picture here. So it's possible, you can imagine orbits in a finite volume space which are closed but do not have finite volume themselves. But this is very strange. Okay, this is not strange, this is like that. What Danny Margulis recurrence theorem tells you that this behavior of the geodesic flow of this group L0 never happens with unipotent elements. So it tells you that there is a lot of recurrence when you are dealing with unipotent elements. So it tells you that if you take ut be a unipotent one parameter group, then there is a lot of recurrence, meaning the picture is not at all like that. The picture is more, let me draw the picture for the unipotent here. So this will be for the action of ut. In fact, the statement tells you that starting from every point, you will be able to find some compact set such that if you look at your orbit starting from x, maybe sometimes it goes away in the cusp, but then it comes back. And I don't know, but I should. Okay, my picture is not so good. But what the statement will tell you is that it never goes to infinity that way. It always comes back and spend most of its time in a compact set. So precise statement is, each time I fix an epsilon positive, I'm able to, for every point in x0. So the notations are the same as proposition 2. Unipotent parameter group of g0. So those are the same notation as Aumur. Okay? For every epsilon positive, for every x in x0, I'm able to find k inside x0 compact such that for every time, the proportion of time you look at all the time in 0 t that you have spent in k the proportion of time you have spent in k between 0 and t is at least 1 minus epsilon. So it's a recurrence property of the unipotent flow. So those two statements have a very strong ergodic flavor. And what I want to do is to explain why proposition 2 is a consequence. Of fact, these two facts. Okay? So so this is the only part of the talk where there will be a proof. So there is a proof now. Yeah, questions? Yeah, thank you.
When you say x naught has finite volume,
yes.
Which volume are you? We're talking about the volume of.
Yeah, this is just a way to write then S0 intersection lambda is the lattice in S0. So this is the precise statement. This means that the quotient of S0 by S0 intersection lambda 0 for the R measure of S0 is finite volume. And this quotient, in fact, this is S0 over S0 intersection lambda 0. But for sure, as we have seen in the picture, we are dealing with a smaller dimensional orbit. So you must not choose the R measure of x0 to compute this volume. It will be zero always. Okay, so let me give the proof of proposition two. So I have to tell you the data is, I'm here. I have this space x0 and I have this point x0. So I have to tell you what is I consider what is my Hilbert space, which Hilbert space I which unitary representation of S0 I will choose. So I choose for my Hilbert space, I choose the L2 function on x0, but with respect to lambda 0. And what is important here is that lambda 0 is not the invariant measure on g0 over lambda 0, but on the orbit. So lambda 0 is the S0 invariant measure on the orbit S0, x0. So we know that on this quotient, S0 over S0 intersection lambda 0, I have an invariant measure, but we don't know whether this measure is finite volume or infinite volume, and we want to prove its finite volume. So we introduce this measure on S0, but think of it as a measure on x0, because you have an orbit in x0. Since the orbit is closed, what you get, lambda 0, is still a Radon measure on x0. It's finite on compact set. So, and then, what is the representation? I compute pi 0 of some function, phi. So pi 0 of s of some function phi, if I compute it in x, it's just, I'm just letting my element s act, it's phi in s minus 1 x0. So lambda 0 is invariant, this will give you a unitary representation. This is the way you act. Okay. So now I have my Hilbert space. And how do I choose ut? Choose ut. Ut a priori is in g0. But anywhere in g0, it has just to be unipotent. But I will take it in s0. And I manage so that we will be in this setting here to have non-trivial image in all SI. So now I'm able to apply both theorems together. For every point x on x0, I will be able to find a compact set for which this condition is true. So since it's true for any point x0, and since you have only countably many compact sets, up to, if you can look at the increasing sequence of compact sets, you extract a countable family of a set like that. And so this means that you are able to find a set A of positive measure for which the same compact set works for everybody. So I know that there exists A inside x0 of positive measure such that, and then there is a compact set which works for any point in A. There exists K inside x0 compact, such that for every point in A, my condition star is true. This is my condition star. So what I do is I integrate this condition over A. Let me compute this integral over A. Or another way, we'll see it's the same. What I compute is I compute the coefficient. Let me compute the coefficient. Maybe I need more room so to do my computation. Let's try here. So I need more room. I think I have more room here. Not so sure. Okay. So what is the what do I want to compute? I want to compute the coefficient. Sorry? Ah, derrière. Ah, merci. Yeah, I have more room here. Thank you. So I want to compute pi of, say, u minus t. And the two vectors I'm choosing are the characteristic function of A, which is in L2. I choose A of finite volume. And the characteristic function of K. This is pi 0. I compute that, and what is this? This is just the measure. It's just a definition. It is the measure of the intersection UTA intersection K. The scalar product in L2 is just the integral of the product. And I want to compute the integral of the product of these two functions. And this function is just the characteristic function of UTA. So it's just the total measure of UTA intersection K. OK, so when you look at this formula, you really understand that coefficient of unitary representation have a very strong meaning in terms of ergodic properties, because you see it as a measure of intersection of two subsets. So we want to study this coefficient. By our Moore, it should go to zero. But by Danny Margulis, we will have an information in average. So I'm just averaging between zero and t. 1 over t, this quantity. So it still goes to 0 by our Moore. No, OK. I will not say it like that. I will compute on the right-hand side. It's an integral dt. Integral dt. And you rewrite this. It's a double integral because you have integral over time and you have integral over the space. Lambda 0 is the integral of this characteristic function. So you exchange it. And what you find is that it is equal to the integral over point in A. So the integral over A. And what you look at is whether ut of a point in A belongs to K. That's what you are looking. You are looking at the integral of over A d lambda 0 of x. But you are doing an average in time. So what you are looking is a set of t in 0t for which ut of x is in k. And you take the proportion of that between 1 and t. So it's a rewriting of this. You have applied Fubini. What I'm saying is the average mass in time of the intersection nu ta with k is the same as the integral over A of the average time the point x in A have spent in k. Okay. So what we know is that this is uniformly larger than 1 minus epsilon. So what we get, it is larger than 1 minus epsilon number 0 A. So it's strictly positive. Strictly positive. It's bounded below independently of t, for every t. So this tells you that this does not go to zero. And so you apply Aumur. Aumur tells you it has to go to zero, except if there are invariant vectors. If it does not go to zero, it means you have invariant vector. But you see in a Hilbert space like that, L2 of x0, with invariant measure, if in L2 you have in L2 of an orbit, you have an invariant vector. This invariant vector is the function 1. And this means that the function 1 is integrable. So this means the volume of lambda 0 of my orbit is finite. Okay, so I have proven the finiteness of the orbit, or the volume of the orbit. Are there questions?
Could you please repeat the very last step?
Yes. You are here. You have found that this Hilbert space contains S0 invariant vector.
Yes.
Okay. What is this Hilbert space? It is L2, I call it L2 x0 lambda 0. But lambda 0 is a measure supported by the orbit. It's invariant measure supported by the orbit. So in fact, this space here, H0, is nothing that L2 S0 over S0 intersection lambda 0. That's another way to write it. So, and if you have a S0 invariant vector there, it has to be the constant function. That's the only. So this means that the constant function is square integrable.
Yes.
So the volume is finite. Okay. So, yes?
How do you choose UT? Why does it exist?
So I assume implicitly that my semi-simple group has no compact factor. So in any semi-simple group with no compact, in any non-compact simple group, you always have a unipotent one-parameter subgroup. For instance, in SL2R, it's very easy to have one. I will apply this to my group S0 will be SL2R cross SL2R. So there, it's very easy to see that you have a unipotent one-parameter unipotent group. Thank you. Yes?
So in the assumption of fact 1, you need the S0 to be the direct product of
the... It's not very important. You can go up to... maybe it's not exactly a product. It may be a product modulo finite center. Maybe I forgot to say that S0 everywhere has finite center. To be safe, I mean, at least for this statement, maybe you have to assume S0 as finite center. And maybe it may not be exactly a product. You can, but in the application, I want to apply it to SL2R cross SL2R. So maybe it's not the best Hausdorff theorem, but it's enough for what you want. Yes?
In fact, too.
Yes.
You have for all x, there is some compact.
Yes.
And here...
What I'm saying is that, okay, this compact set, I take... There is some compact set, so if I take a bigger one, it's even better. So I take a sequence kn of compact set, which cover your space. So then you look at the set of points for which this property is true for kn. So you call it an. And so you have increasing sequence of measurable set, an, whose union is everything. So at least one of them has positive measure. Thank you. Other questions? Yes?
Just a quick question on notation. On the second board there, you have pi naught of, is that an S?
This is a S, yes.
Yes.
And then that S is in one of the SIs, or?
Sorry?
Where does that S belong?
S belongs to S0. You see, it's a unitary representation of S0. So this means it's a morphism from S0 to the unitary transformation of my Hilbert space. So pi of S0, this object here, will be a unitary transformation of my Hilbert space H0. It's a unitary transformation, so I can apply it to some vector. I get another vector of H0 and do the scalar product. That's what coefficients are. Other questions? So what is nice at the end of the day that where we arrived is that we got this information. Conclusion. If I introduce let gamma prime be the group spanned by delta and delta minus, and gamma double prime equal the normalizer of G of gamma prime, we have proven that we know that gamma double prime intersection L0 is infinite. We have found elements, maybe not in gamma, but in the normalizer. Maybe you can think of gamma, I replace gamma by gamma prime, but it's not very important. So you may think of gamma as being this group, spanned by delta and delta minus. And we have found element in the normalizer of gamma, which belong infinitely many elements, because it's a lattice there in L0, infinitely many elements which belong to L0. A priori, we have element in U. We have element in U minus, a lot. And what we have found through this argument, a lot of element in L0. And since I have 5 minutes left, I will just say a few words how I conclude now. All the work was to achieve this because Margulis first proof of the arithmetic theorem for non-compact lattice did not really use the fact that the group was a lattice, but it used that here you have some infinite group. So let me write it. And so this is all what I have to keep from let me now explain very quickly that now I just apply previously known result, which is from infinite stabilizer to to arithmeticity. How do you do that? You apply this result of Margulis. Which is Margulis construction of Q-form. It does not state it like that, but if you look at the proof, this is what it proves. It tells you that if that's the same assumption as the theorem, like in theorem, if gamma intersection L is infinite, maybe a lattice like here, or L0 is infinite, then gamma is included in some Q form. So there exists some Q form of G for which gamma is included in GQ. And then I want to split this fact in two. This way I wrote fact three, and now I will want to state the fact four. Here we are just inside some GQ, the Q point, maybe inside the Z point. And but when you are inside the Z point, there is a very old result that I want to quote of Raghunathan. And then Kataramana in the 80s. Then Kataramana. Which tells you, under the same assumption of you are in the situation of the conclusion of Margulis theorem, but it was completely independent. It was if the assumption is that if gamma is included in GZ, assume gamma is included in the Z point of a Q group, so. And gamma is the residence, and gamma intersection some uz is co-compact in U. Gamma intersection U is co-compact in U for like in the theorem. So the only thing I want to say is that the theorem was known also under the extra assumption that, in fact, gamma is already in some Z form. If gamma happens to be in GZ, if gamma intersection U is co-compact in U, then gamma has finite index in GZ. So it's like this fact. Let me quote special cases. You are, for instance, in SL4Z. You assume you are in SL4Z. You have a subgroup in SL4Z. And you assume it intersects the upper the group U as a finite index subgroup in the Z4 when B is in the 2x2 matrices with coefficient in Z. So it's just finite index there. It's Zariski-Dance. And then what they conclude is that then the whole group has finite index in GZ. So it's this. And so this fact has a very long story in the 70s related to the congruent subgroup problem. It was interesting for people from doing arithmetics and studying arithmetic groups. And for instance, the case where it's SLDZ is due to Titz and Wasserstein. But okay, general result is there. And how do I put everything together? No, it's very easy, because I don't have this information for gamma here. I have the information for gamma double prime. But you have the exercise sheet. And in the exercise sheet, you have seen that if a group is discrete and Zariskidans, its normalizer is also discrete and Zariskidans. So let me finish the proof of theorem. So gamma double prime is discrete and Zariskidans. So by the fact 3, this implies that gamma double prime is included in some GQ. Okay. But then the group gamma prime intersection GZ satisfies the assumption of a fact 4. So by the fact 4, this group gamma prime inter GZ has finite index in GZ. And gamma 2, because gamma prime intersection GZ is included in gamma. And okay, so gamma also. So the end of the proof is, I don't want to enter the details. As I have already told you, there are written notes of this series of four lectures on my webpage. It's 40 pages long. All the details of are written down there. In particular, there is a full proof of Margulis theorem, fact 3. And also of fact 4 for SLDZ. So you will see what kind of arguments are there. And now I think I stop, and in the next lecture I will study 3x3 matrices. Do the same with 3x3 matrices, see what is similar, what is different.